Hello, and welcome to our third and final session of Competition and Monopoly. Today, we're going to be talking about some applications of monopoly theory, and my suggested readings for today are Dominic Armentano's book, Antitrust, The Case for Repeal, an article by Don Boudreau and Tom DiLorenzo called The Protectionist Roots of Antitrust, and then some material from the EconLog blog written by David Henderson on the minimum wage or labor market monopsony. We'll be talking about that a little bit later. But let's start by reviewing briefly what we've learned up to this point. So mainstream or neoclassical economists have a particular understanding of competition and monopoly that seems strange to many laypersons and certainly doesn't square with what we Austrian economists believe. So in the neoclassical approach to competition and monopoly, competition is a situation or a scenario in which you have a large number of very small firms, each of which faces a perfectly elastic demand curve for its product. In other words, each firm can sell as much or as little as it wants at the going price without influencing that price at all. In other words, the firms are what they call price takers. The result is that all firms set prices equal to marginal cost in order to maximize their profits. And in the long run, all firms earn exactly zero profit. This is thought to be the most efficient, the most fair, most productive sort of way of organizing production in an economy. In contrast, monopoly in the neoclassical perspective is the situation or scenario in which you have a single firm in a market. This firm faces a downward sloping demand curve for its product because it's the only firm in the market. So it sets the price in that market, or rather it chooses a price quantity combination on the market demand curve. In other words, here there's no difference between the demand curve facing an individual firm and the demand curve facing the market as a whole, because there's only one firm in the market. That firm is the market. So this firm is able to increase its profits by setting a price not equal to marginal cost, but by setting a quantity where marginal revenue is equal to marginal cost, and then bumping the price up to charge the maximum the market will bear. And this firm is able to earn profits, even in the long run, by exercising its so-called market power. Now, as we've discussed in the last two meetings, there are many problems with this particular approach to competition and monopoly. Austrian economists, by contrast, view competition as a situation in which there are no legal barriers to production and exchange. Anyone is free to enter a market, to try his or her hand at producing, and either to succeed or fail based on entrepreneurial skill, based on the productivity of the resources that firm has at its disposal. Consumers decide which products they favor or disfavor, and the result can have many different outcomes. You could have a few small firms, or rather a few large firms. You could have many small firms, some large firms, some small firms, even just one large firm at that particular moment. As long as any entrepreneur is free to enter the market or to exit, then that market is competitive, regardless of how many firms we tend to see at any particular point in time. In other words, the emphasis for the Austrians is not on the particular structure of the market at that moment. How many firms? What's the size distribution of firms? What's the distribution of profit among firms? But rather, the emphasis is on entrepreneurship, uncertainty, and change. Monopoly, by contrast, for the Austrians, is a situation where you have some artificial restriction on entry. You have something that limits the ability of entrepreneurs to enter and compete in that market. Now, for Mises, that situation existed in the very rare and unusual case where a firm has some unique input that is required to produce a good or service, So that firm is the only plausible producer in that particular market. Plus you have an inelastic demand for the firm's product above the price that otherwise would have obtained in the absence of the firm having a unique resource, the so-called competitive price. And for Mises, this situation can be analyzed, but it's rare and it's not particularly important. Rothbard and Armentano, following Rothbard's lead, have a different view in which the only thing you need for competition is the absence of legal restrictions. In other words, monopoly exists when you have legal protection, when a particular firm has legal protection against competition. The only way monopoly prices can emerge, according to Rothbard and Armentano, is when the government has effectively deemed a particular producer as the only legitimate or only legal producer in that market. Otherwise, the prices that obtain are necessarily competitive prices, no matter how high or low, no matter how many firms there are, and so forth. Again, the emphasis here is on entrepreneurship, uncertainty, and change. If the government puts artificial barriers in the way of entrepreneurs seeking to bear those uncertainties by trying out different combinations of resources, by trying to produce different goods and services, and so forth, as long as you don't have that, you don't have monopoly. Now, why is this so important? Well, according to neoclassical economists, the situation of monopoly, as they understand it, leads to some very harmful consequences for the public, right? Consumers pay prices that are higher than they otherwise would be, and consumers don't get as much output from the industry as they would if the industry were not monopolized. And therefore, the government needs to step in and do something about it. Now, what should the government do? Well, one option would be for the government, according to neoclassical economists, would be for the government to leave the monopolist in place, to leave the sort of structure of the market as it is, but simply to dictate a price or a quantity that corresponds to the so-called competitive level. So if you look at this diagram here on slide number 3, this is the sort of standard neoclassical analysis of monopoly as we looked at it before. So you have a firm facing a downward sloping demand curve for its product, that's the red line, and an upward sloping marginal cost curve, that's the blue line. But when the demand curve is downward sloping, associated with that demand curve is a marginal revenue curve, the green one, the green line, which is also downward sloping, but is more steeply sloped than the demand curve and lies to the left of the demand curve. So the monopolist chooses the quantity QM, where the blue marginal cost line intersects the green marginal revenue curve, but then sets the price all the way up at PM. In other words, the highest price you can charge and still clear that quantity, still sell that quantity of goods. And that's found by going up to the red demand curve. So according to the neoclassical analysis, this is harmful because there's a deadweight loss, the yellow triangle, representing sort of potential output that could have been produced and could have been sold to consumers, but is not because the monopolist is trying to maximize its profits. So what could the government do about this in the neoclassical framework? Well, the government could simply order this monopolist, set up a regulatory agency that has the legal authority to choose prices and quantities, and just say, hey, you're not going to charge PM. We hereby order you to charge a lower price, PC, and we hereby order you to increase production to QC, right? So that price quantity pair, PC and QC, that's the price and quantity that would obtain under perfect competition, so-called. And therefore, you can keep the company there, keep the monopolist there, but just say, hey, we legally force you to act like a perfectly competitive market. So, you know, maybe this is the steel industry and the government sets up a steel board with the authority to command prices and quantities. Or this might be a regulated public utility, a water company or an electric company, which is privately owned, the way it's typically done in the U.S. Right. So in the U.S., most public utilities, water, electricity, gas, and so forth, are private companies. they're privately owned companies with shareholders who receive a dividend and so forth. But the government chooses one company and says, you're the only company that can operate in this market in exchange for having the legal right to sell water or to sell electricity or gas in this market. You have to be subject to our price setting authority. So we choose the price and we tell you what price to charge. In reality, they typically don't charge, require the monopolist to price at something like PC. They choose something, you know, lower than PM, but greater than PC. And the exact price that they charge depends on kind of the political power of the electric company or the gas company and the water company or the water company compared to the voting power of consumers. There's a slightly more complicated case that some of you may have studied in school, what's called natural monopoly. What natural monopoly means in the neoclassical framework is a situation where because of the technical aspects of production, if you have very high initial investment, high fixed cost, but low marginal cost, in other words, to supply electricity, first you have to build a very expensive nuclear power plant. But once you have it built, you can produce marginal units of electricity at a very low marginal cost. You know, you've already got the plant, you just run it a tiny bit harder. So therefore, the average cost of production, rather than being U-shaped, as in the typical case, is sort of continually downward sloping. So you have a marginal cost curve that is also continually downward sloping, and therefore requiring the firm to produce where price is equal to marginal cost would make the firm earn a loss because the revenues would be less than its costs at any level of output because marginal cost is always below average cost. So in that case, the regulator is supposed to set a price that's kind of in between the competitive price and the monopoly price, sort of a break-even price. What's the lowest price we can force this firm to charge such that it still is able to cover its costs or is able to cover its costs plus earn, you know, a 5% rate of return for shareholders or something like that. So the point is, in either case, the solution supposedly in this model is, you know, whatever the market structure may be, if you have a single firm with an upward sloping marginal cost curve or a single firm with a downward sloping marginal cost curve, the regulator just works with the firm to set a price that is reasonable, that allows the firm to break even or maybe make a tiny little bit of profit, but is not the level, it's not the price and quantity that the firm would choose on its own that gives it the highest possible profit. So this is the regulator supposedly stepping in and protecting consumers from high prices while allowing the firm to make enough to sort of get by. Now, there are a number of problems with using price regulation and quantity regulation as a remedy for the inefficiencies and harms that are supposedly caused by monopoly. One obvious problem is a sort of version of Hayek's knowledge problem. In other words, it's fine for us to draw these pretty pictures. We can draw these diagrams, you know, on the blackboard or in a PowerPoint file and say, oh, yes, obviously the price that maximizes overall efficiency is this one right here and point to it. Therefore, I command the firm, I, the omniscient regulator, you know, to produce this quantity and charge this price. But of course, in reality, these curves are not given to us. Right? Demand curves don't actually exist in reality. They're artificial explanatory devices. They're mental constructs that economists use to try to explain particular market outcomes. Marginal cost curves, average cost curves, they also don't exist in reality. They have to be estimated by the entrepreneur who may or may not find these kinds of curves useful. But the point is, I mean, nobody knows what the quote unquote optimal price and quantity is. Even the best intentioned regulator would have no way of knowing exactly what the right price and quantity should be. And if we allow for more realistic, i.e., not perfectly benevolent regulators into our model, they might systematically set the price way too high or way too low, depending on their political preferences, and their cognitive biases, and all kinds of problems. You know, in mainstream economics, in recent years, so-called behavioral models have been all the rage, supposedly showing how market participants are irrational from a psychological point of view and how people make all these unwise decisions and so forth. Well, if you take behavioral economics seriously, why would you want a biased, cognitively limited regulator having the power to set prices and quantities? Sort of a version of this critique is what is sometimes called the theory of the second best. And what this theory suggests is that, you know, all real world markets vary or are different from their sort of blackboard representations in a number of different ways, right? So the monopoly diagram we just looked at on the previous slide supposedly tells us that, you know, the firm in the real world is producing too low a quantity and charging too high a price compared to the, you know, the sort of the nirvana price and quantity that would occur in this hypothetical, perfectly competitive state. But even mainstream economists will acknowledge, yeah, but there might be other sort of imperfections or what they would call market failures. So, for example, suppose that this is an electric utility, and as a byproduct of producing electricity, let's say it's a coal plant. The firm is also polluting, right? It's got too high a carbon footprint. It's contributing to climate change and global warming. And therefore, the blackboard model is not taking into account this negative externality, this harm of pollution. And, you know, if an omniscient regulator knew about the pollution, then as a remedy for the pollution, the regulator would call for the firm to produce a lower quantity. So to solve the inefficiency of monopoly, the regulator is supposed to make the firm increase quantity. To alleviate the pollution problem, the negative externality problem, the regulator is supposed to force the firm to restrict quantity. And there might be a dozen other forms of so-called market failure that the regulator is supposed to take into account. I mean, unless the regulator knows all of these and is able to accommodate all of these, by addressing just one or two through price regulation, the regulator might be pushing the actual price even farther away from this hypothetical optimum price rather than pushing it closer, right? So maybe the best thing for the regulator to do in this case is not to do anything, because the regulator would have no way of knowing if trying to solve one market failure is making the situation on the whole better rather than worse. Institutional economists, and by here I mean people like Ronald Coase, Harold Demsetz, Oliver Williamson, and others, have pointed to another problem. They say, look, if you take a realistic perspective on regulatory agencies, regulatory bodies, you know, human beings as regulators, leaving aside the behavioral issues that we were talking about, what makes us think that an imperfect real-world regulator would be able to fix the problems caused by an imperfect real-world firm? Harold Demsetz famously called this the Nirvana fallacy. And what he meant was, you know, Nirvana is a state of perfection. In the Nirvana world, you know, everything is just like the perfectly competitive general equilibrium model. All prices and quantities are exactly at their perfect levels and so forth. Demsetz pointed out, well, here we have in front of us a real-world monopoly. Yes, it's going to look like a failure compared to this Nirvana model that we draw on the blackboard. But a real-world regulator is also going to be a failure relative to the Nirvana regulator, or the Nirvana of the regulator of the Nirvana world. So rather than comparing, you know, a realistic unregulated market with a Nirvana regulated market, we should be comparing the realistic unregulated market with the realistic regulated market, in which the regulator, you know, could be bribed, the regulator could have a political agenda, the regulator could just not be very smart, the regulator could simply not have the necessary information. You know, if we do an apples to apples comparison of a realistic unregulated market and a real world realistic regulated market, we might find that the former is preferred to the latter, even on kind of neoclassical grounds. There's a great line from Ronald Coase in one of his articles where he says something like, you know, the problem with the term market failure is that all realistic forms of organization are failures relative to some hypothetical idea. So what we should be comparing is the extent of market failure with the extent of government failure. And it may, of course, depending on the particulars of the situation, be the case that the government failure is bigger than the market failure. So even if we think the market is imperfect, we should just let it alone, because trying to fix it with regulation is sort of a cure that's worse than the disease. Another potential solution, according to mainstream economists, would be to have the government intervene in a different way, right? Rather than leaving this one large firm to dominate the market and then ordering it to choose a different price or quantity or both, the government could simply split up this large firm into several smaller firms using antitrust policy. So antitrust laws in most countries, or the more general term would be competition laws or competition policy. These laws are designed to prevent a single firm from coming to dominate a market, either by restricting or outlawing certain kinds of mergers and acquisitions, or by giving the government the authority, if it finds one large firm dominating a market, to split that firm up, to have the courts order that that firm be separated into two or three smaller firms. So, for example, in the United States, the Standard Oil Company was split up into multiple regional or state-level oil companies as the result of an antitrust decree in U.S. federal court. So antitrust is kind of a weird issue for economists, because even many sort of free market economists, or economists who would consider themselves to be defenders of the free market but come from a neoclassical perspective, are very favorable towards antitrust law. This sort of the Chicago school, Milton Friedman, George Stigler, and others are famous for expounding this particular view. They say that, well, under the free market, monopolies tend to emerge naturally, and it's the responsibility of the government to break them up to make markets more competitive, right? So markets are more closely approximate perfect competition. Now, what Austrian economists like Murray Rothbard or Dominic Armentano would say is, no, that's the wrong free market view. The correct free market view is that the government should refrain from granting monopoly privilege. In other words, from this point of view, anything that emerges in a free and unhampered market is competitive, and the role of government is to stop granting monopolies. So here you have a disagreement among different economists coming from different intellectual traditions, all of whom would consider themselves to be defending the free market. But to the neoclassical economists, the Chicago-style economists, what they mean by the free market is something that is as close as possible to perfect competition. So defending the free market means, you know, they might say, well, unfortunately or regrettably, sometimes we do need the government to interfere to break up monopolies to make sure we have a truly free market. But to Austrian economists, free market doesn't mean perfect competition. It means the absence of government interference. So having the government break up a large firm into several smaller ones would be the opposite of promoting the free market. This would be government interference with the free market. So using the U.S. as an example, because most countries have something similar, in the late 19th century, there were a number of important pieces of legislation passed by Congress, the most important being the Sherman Act, named after one of its sponsors, Senator Sherman. This was the first major piece of antitrust legislation in the United States, and one of the first in the world. And the legislation is written so that it outlaws what are called restraints on trade through monopolistic practices. So, you know, one large firm dominating a market and keeping other firms out simply by virtue of its large size or its superior efficiency would be considered a restraint on trade. There are other actions like a group of firms forming a cartel. So if two or three firms got together and agreed that they would all charge the same price for a good or service, they agreed to refrain from competing against each other in price, this would also be considered a restraint on trade and would be illegal under the Sherman Act. So the whole series of so-called monopolistic practices that are outlawed by this legislation, and Dominic Armentano's little book goes through them in great detail. A later piece of legislation, or some later pieces of legislation, expanded the notion of restraints on trade. For example, the Clayton Act, passed during 1914, outlawed price discrimination, which is charging different prices to different consumers for the identical good, or what's called tying, which is having as a condition of sale that the customer also buy another good. So you can buy my water bottle, but only if you also buy my soft drink. This is also illegal under antitrust laws. The Robinson-Patman Act of 1936 outlaws so-called predatory pricing, which is the term for a situation where one firm that might be more efficient than its rivals tries to undercut its rivals by charging a price below their average cost, which would be unprofitable for these rivals, and thus would sort of drive them out of the market. Of course, this would also potentially result in losses for the firm engaged in so-called predatory conduct. But Armentano has a nice description of how these laws work and some of the problems with them. Now, there are a number of practical problems with the standard approach to antitrust policy or competition policy in most countries. I mean, one I've sort of already hinted at, and that's that it's not obvious that you should infer monopoly power in the neoclassical sense merely by observing firm size. So you could have a market in which one firm has all of the sales or a large, 75% of the sales, not because it engaged in monopolistic practices, not because it engaged in predatory pricing, or because there was some sort of secret cartel agreement, or because the firm has some nefarious way of keeping others out of the market. It may be that the firm is simply more efficient than its rivals, right? So large market share, rather than being the cause of superior performance, as in neoclassical monopoly theory, may be the consequence of superior efficiency and hence superior financial performance, right? So competition law provides a built-in disincentive for any firm to be particularly effective, right? I mean, if I enter some market, to sell water, and I'm a very clever entrepreneur, I have some innovative technology or a new way of marketing or distributing water, if I am so successful that I come to be the dominant water company in my location, in my city or region or whatever, then I'm, subject to potential antitrust prosecution. And so why would I want to be that good, right? I don't want to be so large that I am subject to prosecution by the feds. Second practical problem relates to defining the relevant market. So I'm broadcasting here from my office at Baylor University in Waco, Texas. Suppose that I am so good at producing and selling bottled water that I end up having 100% of the share, 100% market share here in Waco, Texas. So am I a monopolist? Well, I mean, if we define the market as, water bottles that are, let's see, how big is this one? How many ounces? This is 20 ounces. If we define the market as 20-ounce bottles of purified water, then we'd say, yeah, I have 100% of that market here in Waco, Texas. But what about, what if I don't sell 10-ounce bottles of water, but some other firm does? I don't dominate the market for smaller bottles of water or larger bottles of water. Are large bottles of water, do they represent competition to my water bottles? Well, I mean, that's up to the consumers. Many consumers might think, if Klein tries to jack up the price of these, we're simply going to buy large jugs of water and fill smaller bottles ourselves. What about tap water? is if tap water is safe to drink, then is that a competitor to my bottled water? What about bottled tea? What about soft drinks? What about coffee? There's any number of beverages that under certain circumstances could be substitutes for water. Is the market just Waco, Texas, or does it include the surrounding areas? Is it the entire state of Texas? I mean, in principle, I could ship my water. I could put it up on eBay or Alibaba or something and sell it all around the world. So there's no objective scientific way to determine what is the relevant market that a particular firm, you know, has supposedly monopolized. That's really sort of just an arbitrary decision of some economist or some government official who simply decides, oh, you're dominating this market. Well, what market, right? I mean, for almost any good or service, we can imagine potential competitors. You say, oh, well, in most countries, the government has a legal monopoly on postal mail. So in the United States, we say the U.S. Postal Service has a monopoly on mail, which is why a lot of people hate using the mail, right? But, you know, what about email? Is email a substitute for sending a printed letter? Yeah, in most cases it is. You can have a document, you can scan it, and you can email it to somebody. Overnight shipping companies like UPS, FedEx, DHL, to some degree they compete with postal mail. You know, shouting a message to somebody could be a substitute. Calling somebody on the phone and having a conversation as opposed to sending a paper letter is a kind of competitor, right? So, I mean, it's always ultimately arbitrary what we define to be the relevant market. So the whole concept of market share is really not a scientific concept because it depends on a potentially arbitrary and subjective determination of what the market is. There are a number of practical problems with antitrust law in most countries. So in the United States, for example, a government agency can file an antitrust suit against a company, both the Federal Trade Commission and the Department of Justice Antitrust Division can file suits, but also private competitors can file antitrust suits. Right, so some other entrepreneur in my town who, you know, maybe the guy I've totally outcompeted by selling superior bottled water, he could file an antitrust suit in federal court against me saying that I've engaged in some nefarious tactics to drive him out of the market. Well, maybe consumers just preferred my product to his, but now I face the prospect of a potentially long and very costly antitrust suit filed by my competitor. So antitrust law can be used opportunistically by politically connected or, sort of legally sophisticated but economically inefficient rivals to punish their more efficient competitors. And the article by Boudreau and DiLorenzo does a great job looking at the actual legislative history of antitrust in the U.S., and they show that contrary to what, you know, high school students are told and college students are told, that in the U.S. antitrust law was created to prevent these horrible monopolists like John D. Rockefeller and Andrew Carnegie and so forth from, you know, exploiting the consumer and driving other firms out of the market. No, in fact, it was these large industrialists, the so-called robber barons, who were extremely efficient. They were continually expanding output and continually lowering prices such that less efficient firms couldn't compete. So these less efficient firms went to the government and said, oh, they're engaged in predatory pricing. They're pricing so low that we can't compete. We want you to force them to stop doing that. In other words, we want prices to be higher so that we can compete and make more money. Another practical problem is that, even if you believe that, yeah, in theory, antitrust law is a good way to prevent firms from dominating the market or exercising monopoly power, I mean, in practice, if you're going to use, you know, we talked about regulatory bodies before, if you're going to use the court system to enforce antitrust laws, well, I mean, antitrust trials can take a very long time. They're very complicated. You know, all these issues about market definition that I referred to before, different experts arguing about whether a price really is a monopoly price or not. I mean, these suits can take months or years, or in some cases, even decades. But, you know, actual markets, competition in real markets is very rapid. Competition is quick, especially in markets where there's a lot of technological innovation. A great example of this is the famous antitrust case against IBM in the United States in the 1970s, which lasted for, I think 13 years before the government finally dropped the suit. And the reason that they dropped the suit was because IBM had been accused of monopolizing the market for mainframe computers. Well, a decade or more into the trial, people all of a sudden realized that that market didn't exist anymore, right? Because the desktop PC had been introduced and had basically wiped out the mainframe computer industry. So the industry that IBM was alleged to have monopolized no longer existed. There's a great book on this by a neoclassical economist, Frank Fisher, called Folded, Spindled, and Mutilated, published in 1985, which is a great history of the huge waste of time and effort and money that went into this antitrust suit. More recent example would be several antitrust suits filed both in the U.S. and Europe against Microsoft. So in the 1990s, Microsoft was accused of using its so-called monopoly on the desktop, right? The fact that 90-something percent of new PCs were being shipped with Microsoft Windows pre-installed to dominate the emerging market for web browsers. So some, I don't know how many of you use Internet Explorer as your primary browser. I'm guessing not very many, and probably even fewer use Microsoft's newer version, Edge, it's called. Most of you use Google Chrome or maybe Mozilla Firefox, or use the browser on your phone, whatever that might be, Safari, et cetera. But it was in the mid-90s when the Federal Trade Commission filed this antitrust suit against Microsoft, accusing them of trying to drive other browsers out of the market. I mean, the funny thing is that that suit dragged on for years. Microsoft finally signed a consent decree where it agreed not to require manufacturers to put Internet Explorer on the desktop as a precondition of allowing them to pre-install Microsoft Windows on their computers. But I mean, again, the whole thing's technologically obsolete now, because the market decided that it preferred other browsers, in particular Google's Chrome browser and Apple's Safari, to Internet Explorer. So Internet Explorer would have died anyway. I mean, the point is, even firms with very large market shares cannot impose their will on consumers. Consumers can always choose the products and services that they like. And if a product is not good in the mind of the consumer, subjectively determined, then no amount of bundling or tying, no attempt to leverage market power is going to succeed in forcing consumers to buy something that they don't want. Now, there are a number of theoretical problems as well, and we've already discussed them, right? According to Rothbard, there is no scientific means of determining or distinguishing in the real world monopoly prices from competitive prices, other than the existence of government-created entry barriers. And therefore, I mean, there's no monopoly problem to solve with antitrust law, right? There's no purpose to antitrust law. The only role of government in terms of mitigating monopoly problems is simply not to grant monopoly privilege, right? So, I mean, if you accept the theoretical apparatus of the Austrian school, the case for antitrust law just sort of dissolves. I mean, it addresses a problem that doesn't exist in the Austrian understanding of the competitive market process. There's also kind of, a legal problem, namely that antitrust laws are what they call ex post facto, meaning there is no way for a firm to determine ahead of time if a particular behavior or conduct violates antitrust law, right? I mean, the hallmark of a well-functioning legal system is objectivity and transparency in the nature of the law and people's ability to understand the law, right? I should know ahead of time whether I'm committing robbery or not. It would be very strange to have a law that says, well, if you break into someone's house and you take something that belongs to them that may or may not be robbery, depending on how the court is feeling that day. I mean, then I wouldn't really know if what I'm doing is legal or not. That would be confusing. That would be, you know, difficult and so forth. It's kind of a silly example because it's obvious to us that breaking into somebody's house and taking their stuff is not right. But, you know, in antitrust, it doesn't work that way. Actually, there's a great article by Alan Greenspan back in his Randian days where he discussed this problem in some detail, that, you know, no firm can know ahead of time whether it's violating antitrust law or not, because antitrust law is deliberately vague, right? Firms are forbidden from engaging in actions, for example, that would constitute an illegal restraint of trade. Okay, well, I've expanded my output of water bottles with new production equipment, and I've increased my market share from 70% here in Waco, Texas, to 80% of the market for 20-ounce bottles of purified water. Have I violated the Sherman Act? I don't know. I mean, maybe I have. A court could rule that, oh yeah, 80% is too high. But another court could rule that, no, that's perfectly fine. Right, so I don't have any way of knowing whether my actions are legal or not, which puts you into kind of this bizarro world where you live, you know, not under the rule of law, but the rule of men. And so it's a real problem for companies, especially large companies. And I think in a free market, absent antitrust law, there might be competitive pressures that would allow firms to grow even larger than they do now. So this is an artificial limit on firm size and scope in the real world. You know, the smaller you are, the less likely you are to be a target of an antitrust suit. But the larger and more successful you are, the more likely you'll be the target of a government-launched or a competitor-launched antitrust suit. And this is a real cost, the uncertainty and the actual legal costs of going through a suit are something that is really harmful to large companies. There's a very funny book, a cartoon book, that nicely illustrates this point. It's by R.W. Grant, called Tom Smith and His Incredible Bread Machine. I think you can find the whole thing online. It's a sort of a comic yet tragic story of an entrepreneur who invents this wonderful machine, but then is sort of attacked by the government and by inefficient rivals, and he's sort of quashed by the state. There's a great line, it's written as poetry in the book, where some government bureaucrat is explaining to Tom Smith what he's done wrong, and the bureaucrat says the following. He says, "You're gouging on your prices if you charge more than the rest, but it's unfair competition if you think you can charge less. A second point that we would like to make to help avoid confusion, don't try to charge the same amount, that would be collusion." In other words, if the protagonist charges a higher price than his rivals, then he is engaged, he's exploiting his market power by price gouging. If he charges less than his competitors, he's exploiting his market power through predatory pricing. If he charges the same as his competitors, he's engaged in illegal collusion. So no matter what he's doing, it's illegal according to the government. So imagine being in that situation yourself and having no idea what you can do that would be legal. Now, my old dissertation advisor and 2009 Nobel laureate Oliver Williamson made some interesting arguments, really coming from a neoclassical perspective, but a more subtle and more savvy neoclassical perspective, against the standard treatment of antitrust and monopoly. Williamson points out that even within the neoclassical framework, a large firm with a large market share, you know, might actually have a lower per unit cost than smaller firms. In other words, consumers might actually benefit from the superior efficiency of the monopolist, even while they are, you know, harmed, quote unquote, by the monopolist charging higher prices. And Williamson showed in an article in the 1960s that depending on how you do the math and how you do the diagrams, the efficiency gain could outweigh the loss of consumer welfare for monopoly pricing, such that even within the neoclassical framework, there might be cases where it's better for the market to permit monopoly rather than competition. I mean, what this article, I think, nicely does is highlight kind of the arbitrariness of the neoclassical framework in this context, that you can, depending on how you set the parameters, you could get any number of market structures being sort of optimal from the consumer's point of view, and there's simply no way to come up with a consistent policy on what firms should or should not be allowed to do if your goal is to improve consumer well-being. But Williamson is even better known for his later work on vertical integration. Vertical integration describes a case where a particular firm owns more than one productive stage, right? So if I, if I'm a bottler, if I bottle and sell purified water, but I also own the delivery trucks that take the bottled water to retail stores, and maybe I own my own retail store that sells the bottled water, then I have a vertically integrated production process. And many parts of antitrust law, particularly the Robinson-Patman Act, effectively make certain kinds of vertical integration illegal because this is viewed as a illegitimate attempt to exploit or leverage monopoly power in one productive stage to sort of dominate another productive stage. Williamson in particular attacked what are called vertical restraints. So for example, resale price maintenance, that describes a case where suppose that I produce these bottled waters and then I sell them to a number of retailers, grocery stores, convenience stores. It's illegal under antitrust law for me to set a minimum price. In other words, for me to say to a convenience store, I'll sell you all these water bottles, but I don't want you to charge anything less than $1 a bottle. And maybe that's because I'm also selling them through my own stores at $1 a bottle. I don't want the convenience store to charge a lower price than mine. That would be illegal under the Robinson-Patman Act. And Williamson argued that, no, in fact, vertical restraints like resale price maintenance and territorial restrictions and other kinds of complicated contracts between, say, manufacturers and distributors may actually serve an efficiency purpose in protecting particular kinds of investments that these firms might have to make from sort of opportunistic behavior by other by their trading partners. And he contrasted his approach, in which vertical integration often increases efficiency, to what he called the inhospitality tradition in antitrust. And it's actually a pretty fundamental point. The what Williamson meant by the inhospitality tradition was the tendency for antitrust authorities to view any deviation from perfect competition as per se suspicious. He was focusing specifically on vertical integration, which doesn't happen in perfect competition because there's only one stage of production in perfect competition. So antitrust authorities would encounter some phenomenon in the real world, like resale price maintenance, and say, that doesn't exist under perfect competition, and perfect competition is the ideal. Therefore, resale price maintenance must be bad. It should be illegal. The antitrust law should take it out. Williamson said, no, you need to study phenomena like resale price maintenance carefully, and you may find, and you will find in the typical case, that actually resale price maintenance serves an efficiency purpose, right? It protects, for example, my incentives to invest in certain kinds of water bottling technology. I wouldn't do that if I thought that my resellers would be charging a price below the price that allows me to recover my cost for producing that, investing in that technology. So I think it's actually a pretty profound point that, essentially we should throw perfect competition out the window. Perfect competition should not be used as a welfare benchmark. It just misleads regulators and antitrust authorities and economists and journalists and so forth into thinking that all kinds of complex and innovative market phenomena are suspicious. Rather, we should assume as a default that unusual behavior that emerges on the market is probably in the best interest of consumers, absent government intervention. Now, I want to discuss one final application of monopoly theory, one that you might not have been expecting, and that's an application to the minimum wage. So as you may know, over the last 15, 20 years, there's been a big controversy and debate within the mainstream economics literature on minimum wages and whether minimum wage laws might actually help workers rather than hurt them. Because you see, up until the mid-1990s, almost every economist, certainly all Austrian economists and almost all neoclassical economists, believed that minimum wages were not a very good way to help low-wage workers. And the way most economists understood this can be illustrated with a simple supply and demand diagram like the one I have on this slide here on slide 10. Right, so imagine a market for labor in which you have the price of labor, the wage, on the vertical axis, and the quantity of labor, the amount of employment, on the horizontal axis. Right, and if you have a downward sloping demand curve for labor and an upward sloping supply curve for labor, you get an equilibrium wage. What's indicated here on the diagram is the free market wage, right, where the red line and the blue line intersect. So remember that labor supply represents, or what underlies that labor supply curve is the willingness of workers to take certain kinds of jobs or to supply certain quantities of labor at particular wages. Whereas the demand curve for labor, the downward sloping red line, represents the willingness of employers to hire certain quantities of labor at particular prices. And that comes from what economists call the marginal revenue product of labor. Rothbard used the term marginal value product, but it means the same thing. It's the marginal contribution of a particular unit of labor to the entrepreneur's revenues, the employer's revenues. So the standard story, which is still in most of the economics textbooks, and what I would say is a correct story, right, is that if the government sets a minimum wage above the free market wage, above the market clearing wage, that's going to result in an excess supply of labor, right? So you can see on the diagram there, if the government sets a minimum wage at that higher level, at that price, right, the quantity supplied of labor, where that dashed line intersects the blue labor supply curve, is a larger quantity than what employers would demand at that price, right, where that dashed horizontal line hits the red line, hits the red curve, right? So at the higher minimum wage, at the minimum wage above the free market wage, the quantity of labor supplied is greater than the quantity of labor demanded at that wage, leading to unemployment, right? There are more people wishing to work, or there are more hours of work available than the amount that employers are willing to pay for. So some people get out of work, are thrown out of work, right? So at the higher minimum wage, those workers who can still keep their jobs will actually earn a higher wage than they would have without the minimum wage. But many employees who would like to have worked at a lower wage will be priced out of the market. And so there's an increase in unemployment that goes along with the increase in the minimum wage. And in most cases, that loss will outweigh the gains. So this is why most economists for 100 years or more have believed that the only way to improve the well-being of low-wage workers over time is through productivity gains, right? Capital investment, innovation, and entrepreneurship that increases the marginal productivity of labor and thus increases the demand for labor. That will increase the price on the free market. But for the government to arbitrarily set a price above the market clearing price simply leads to a surplus of the good or service. So that was the traditional explanation for a long time. There were a number of empirical studies in the 1990s by David Card and Alan Krueger and a number of their students and colleagues claiming to show that where different cities and states had increased their minimum wage relative to other cities and states, unemployment had not in fact gone up. And so there must be something wrong with the standard analysis. But it was very difficult to come up with theory that could explain this, right? As long as the demand curve for labor is downward sloping, an increase in the minimum wage above the market clearing level should generate a surplus of labor and unemployment. So there were some attempts to explain away these findings by saying that, well, maybe in fact, workers get paid on multiple margins. They get a money wage, but they also get break time or free tools or free uniform, or if it's, say, the fast food industry, they get free meals. And employers respond to an increase in the money wage by cutting back on those side benefits so that, in fact, you know, even though the money wage has gone up, the actual value of the compensation has stayed the same. And that's why firms don't actually end up employing fewer workers. That's why we don't see a spike in unemployment. There were other economists who critiqued the empirical studies and said that what Card and Kruger had done was actually not correct. They had made a lot of mistakes with their data and so forth. So there's a big controversy about this in among labor economists. But I think most economists were pretty uncomfortable with this view that you can increase the minimum wage without causing unemployment. But more recently, mainstream economists who favor minimum wages have taken a different approach, and that is to appeal to so-called monopsony wages. What is monopsony? Monopsony is a less familiar term than monopoly, but it does appear in some neoclassical economics textbooks, and it's sort of an analogy to monopoly. It also comes from the Greek, where monopoly means single seller. Monopsony means single buyer. So the idea here is, what if you have, say, a particular community where there's one large employer in town, there's one big factory, and that's the only factory in town, and that employs almost everybody in the town. Then, according to this argument, you don't really have a competitive market for labor. So you can't draw supply and demand curves for labor in the usual fashion and say that, well, there are, you know, many workers competing with each other to supply labor, and there are many firms competing with each other to hire labor. In fact, you only have one firm that hires all the labor. So that firm, again, has a kind of a market power on the buyer side compared to the monopoly firm that supposedly has market power on the seller side. Right, so remember, in the market for an input like labor, the suppliers, the sellers, are individual workers. The buyers are employers, firms that hire labor, or whatever the factor is. So if you have one large dominant buyer and a lot of small sellers, this argument goes, the buyer can also exercise a kind of market power. So there's a diagram that is analogous to the monopoly diagram in neoclassical economics. Here we have a downward sloping demand curve, the red line. This is a labor market, supposedly. An upward sloping supply curve. But because instead of many competing buyers, you only have one dominant buyer, that buyer does not have to choose prices where demand equals supply. Rather, that monopsony buyer chooses what quantity to buy by looking at where the marginal revenue curve intersects the marginal cost curve of labor. And the marginal cost of labor under monopsony is higher than, greater than, and it increases more steeply than the supply curve. So you have, whereas under competition, according to this argument, the equilibrium wage would be W prime and the equilibrium quantity would be capital L prime. Under monopsony, the monopsonist chooses a lower quantity of labor, this capital L, and then chooses the lowest possible price that will still allow the monopsonist to hire the required quantity of labor. That's this wage L. So it's kind of analogous to the monopoly diagram, but kind of flipped around. So remember, in the monopoly diagram, the monopolist chooses a quantity where marginal revenue equals marginal cost and then charges the highest possible price the market will bear. Here, the monopsonist chooses a quantity to hire where marginal revenue is equal to marginal cost and then offers the lowest wage the market will bear, this wage W. So the argument that you find coming out just in the last 5 years or so that supposedly justifies minimum wage laws is that, well, just like we have monopoly in the real world, In the real world, we don't have perfectly competitive labor markets. We have monopsony labor markets. Employers have market power, which allows them to pay wages lower than the equilibrium competitive wage. Therefore, we need minimum wage laws to get the actual wage in the market closer to W prime. Okay? The wage in the market is not good, according to this argument, because employers have monopsony power. They need to be forced to pay higher wages, just as monopoly firms need to be forced to charge lower prices for their outputs. What's wrong with the monopsony argument? Well, lots of things, right? I mean, we could start by approaching this problem the same way that Rothbard and Armentano approached the monopoly problem, right? We can say, well, look, all supply curves in input markets are upward sloping. There's no such thing as a perfectly competitive supply, perfectly competitive labor market. So in the real world, there would be no way to distinguish a competitive input price from a monopsonistic input price. In other words, there's no way to know that the wage that actually prevails on the market, the W in the previous, in the graph on the previous slide, is not, you know, that there's anything wrong with that. There's no way to say that there should be a different wage that would be higher, right? Again, a competitive labor market, in Rothbard's sense, does not mean that employers face a perfectly elastic supply curve. They can hire as many workers or as few workers as they want without affecting the going wage. No, all users of resources, all employers of labor, or all employers of any factor, you know, have some ability to influence the price. And so as long as we don't have government interference in the market, as long as new suppliers, new firms are free to enter the market and try to bid those workers away by offering higher prices, then we have a competitive labor market. And we can't say that there's anything inefficient about the wages that prevail. Right? So again, here we're just using the general Austrian notion of competition. And we could say, just as Austrians understand monopoly to be a government grant of special privilege, likewise, they would understand monopsony to have meaning only when you have a government grant of special privilege. But on a practical level, and I think David Henderson does a good job bringing this out in his econ log posts that I asked you to read, I mean, this doesn't make any sense at all for the labor market, for unskilled workers. I mean, it's hard to think of any community where for entry-level work, minimum wage work, you know, flipping burgers at a fast food joint, or, you know, stocking warehouse shelves or bagging groceries. I mean, you know, factories employing skilled workers are not paying minimum wages. They're paying much more than the minimum wage. Minimum wage jobs are typically for highly unskilled labor. Labor is very mobile. So there are lots and lots of potential employers of low-skilled labor. In fact, in most American towns, or at least in many American towns where there's economic growth in those towns, even McDonald's and Burger King and the local grocery stores, they're all paying higher than the minimum wage to attract teenagers, because there's such a demand for unskilled labor that at the minimum wage, if a firm only offered the minimum wage, it wouldn't be able to hire anybody. So it's hard to imagine an actual market where you have no competition among employers for low-skilled labor, or where you have some kind of buyer's cartel. You know, all fast food restaurants agree that they will not pay above the minimum wage. Well, a cartel like that would simply be unsustainable, because it would be in the interest of any individual cartel member to offer a higher wage than the legal minimum wage to try to recruit low-skilled workers away from rivals. I mean, it just doesn't seem to make any sense when applied to labor markets. Remember that labor is the least specific resource of all the resources that are used in production. Unskilled labor in particular. Unskilled labor can be applied to many, many production processes. So you'd have to believe, for this argument to hold, that, you know, McDonald's workers can only work in fast food. They can only flip burgers, and there's only one McDonald's in town, or all the burger restaurants in town have somehow colluded to keep wages down. that's the only way you could make, you know, this story could go through. But like I say, it doesn't make sense. If you can flip burgers, you can do any number of unskilled tasks. And there are lots and lots of potential employers, even in a small town, for unskilled labor. So to me, this is sort of the last gasp of the minimum wage defenders to try to come up with some theoretical rationale for something they just like. They just like minimum wages for political reasons or whatever. They think it's more fair or who knows what. But to me, this is an extremely weak argument. But, I mean, it's worth going over because, you know, once you buy into the neoclassical notion of perfect competition as the ideal, you can find all kinds of ways in which real markets deviate from that ideal, and hence all kinds of rationales for the forms of government intervention that you like best. So, to conclude, what have we learned in these three sessions? Or what do I hope that we have learned? Well, that to an Austrian economist, competition is best understood as a process of rivalry among firms, or we should say among entrepreneurs, workers, investors, suppliers, who are free to compete as they see fit within a given legal framework. So theft is outlawed, maybe certain kinds of fraud are outlawed, but subject with except for those kinds of restrictions, entrepreneurship is free to flourish. That is what competition means, not a certain market structure, not a certain distribution of firm size, not anything that looks like the perfectly competitive model on the blackboard, right? So under competition, true competition, or competition properly understood, we might see few firms or many firms. We might have large firms or small firms. Some firms will earn profits, some will earn losses. Maybe most firms will earn profits, or most will earn losses in the short term, right? What we would expect to see is entry, exit, growth of firms, maybe shrinkage of firms or the industry, innovation and experimentation. We would expect firms to enter and exit, firms to rise and fall, industries to grow and contract. That's part of what a healthy, dynamic market economy looks like. Examining a particular market at a particular point in time and arbitrarily deciding that some market shares are too large is simply an arbitrary and unscientific way to think about markets and competitions and competition. Government attempts to limit so-called monopoly power or market power cannot improve the well-being of individuals in a society. The best government policy towards competition is for the government not to grant monopoly privilege to its favorite firms. So I've really enjoyed having these conversations with you. Thank you for joining us for this Mises Academy course. Please feel free to contact me at any time at pklein@mises.org, pklein@mises.org. And I'd look forward to talking to you about these topics, about the readings, or about anything related to competition and monopoly. So thanks again, and I look forward to seeing you again soon.